Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is Triangulation, episode 246, recorded Monday, April 18th, 2016, at the NAB show. Matthew Wood, supervising editor at Skywalker Sound. Triangulation is brought to you by ScoreBig. Pay less for quality seats to your favorite sporting and music events. Go to scorebig.com, click on the microphone, enter the promo code Triangulation to save $20 off your first ticket purchase. And by DigitalOcean, simple and fast cloud hosting built for developers. Deploy an SSD cloud server in 55 seconds. Try it today for free. Visit DigitalOcean.com, and once you sign up, use the promo code Triangulation in the billing section to get a $10 credit. And by CuriosityStream, a subscription streaming service that offers over 1,400 documentaries and nonfiction series from the world's best filmmakers. Get unlimited access starting at just $2.99 a month. And for our audience, the first 2 months, completely free if you sign up at CuriosityStream.com/TWiT and use the promo code TWiT. It's time for Triangulation, the show where we get together with some of the most interesting people in technology, spend some time with them, get to really know them, and I am so excited. First of all, I should explain why it sounds so different and looks so, if you're watching the video, looks so different. We're at the NAB show, the big broadcaster show that's held every year in Las Vegas. 100,000, I guess, you know, I want to say broadcasters, actually it's about 20,000 broadcasters and 80,000 new media types like you and me. Filling this big Las Vegas Convention Center. All three halls are filled, 1,700 exhibitors. It's really amazing. I'm so glad to be here. We want to thank the folks who are letting this happen at the Live View, who's giving us access to their booth. Actually, I'm the booth babe, so I hope you're enjoying this. Panasonic, who's provided the cameras, including these amazing PTZ cameras, which you'll see in action in just a little bit. And, of course, our friends at NewTek and the TriCaster. They've loaned us TriCaster for use, Brian Burnett. He feels like he's at home, running the show from over there on the TriCaster. I am really thrilled. It's kind of funny. We had to come to Las Vegas to interview our guest who lives in Petaluma. Most of our guests come from far afield, but no. Matthew Wood is a Petaluma, and he's the supervising sound editor at Skywalker, and that is such a good title. Matthew, it's nice to meet you.
Welcome. Very nice to meet you, Leo. It's a pleasure to be on your show. I've always wanted to.
What?
Yes.
Just walk in the door. We're right there.
I
love it that we had to come to Vegas to talk to you in person.
It's a good meeting.
So, gosh, I don't even know where to begin. Let's talk about what a sound editor is.
Sure. I mean, I work out there at Skywalker Ranch. We're the...
That is Valhalla.
It's a pretty amazing location. It was built in the mid-80s by, it's George Lucas's company of... it's now Skywalker Properties.
You can't call it Lucas anymore because Disney.
Well, in the last couple of years ago, we were purchased by Disney.
So you are Disney, part of
yes,
this Disney.
Yes, yeah, we're at, okay. At Skywalker Ranch. The one of the main divisions of Disney that's out there is Skywalker Sound, and so we're part of the toolkit to make these new Star Wars movies. You know, when George sold the company and the intellectual property of Star Wars to Disney, he got Kathleen Kennedy and an amazing producer to come in and run our company to make more movies. And now we're doing one every year. And we're at...
I'm so thrilled by that, by the way.
I'm a huge Star Wars fan. I've been ever since I've been a little kid. And so when I got that job out there at Lucasfilm, it was an absolute dream come true. And I actually never left. I got that job about 26 years ago. Testing video games.
Wait a minute, you must have been four.
I was 17. And
So you got a job, the job every teenager says he's going to get, testing video games. You actually got that job.
You know, and I got it because this was mid to late 80s. I had a bulletin board system that was local in the Bay Area called PopNet.
Oh, and there was I had MacQ. It was a Fido net in the mid 80s.
I was on MacQ.
PopNet?
Yeah, yes.
Holy cow.
Yeah, so PopNet had a little job posting for a quality assurance technician to be working in Nicasio. And I was working in a library at the time, and I went online and I found Nicasio. That's just a bunch of you know, hippies. Agriculture and farms and stuff, but that's no one's going to want a quality assurance technician unless it's going to be Lucasfilm.
Oh, you knew!
So here's the other tech connection to that is that my dad had a fax machine. And not a lot of people had fax machines in their houses at that point. And so I found out what their fax machine was. I faxed my resume to Lucasfilm that I created on Mac Paint.
Nice.
And,
and we had Bill Atkinson on the last show. Nice. So this is all coming great. Around full circle.
So I got a call back saying, hello, is this Matthew Wood? Like, no one has ever faxed us a resume. I went to the top of the pile. The guys want to meet you. So how I got the job out there. I mean, obviously I had to interview and show them what video games.
What games were you testing?
Back then it was Loom.
Loom was great.
Yeah, Loom. Monkey
so these
Island.
Were PC
the first
games.
Monkey Island.
Yeah.
For PC. Also, there was a Towns machine we were playing on. This is like, I don't even know.
Is.
It was like a Japanese.
That was a Japanese
machine. So yeah, it was Loom. It was all DOS at that point. Then there was one Mac game I worked on, Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. It was a movie type, you know, connection.
And what does it mean? Yeah. This is great because my son says, I said, what are you going to do with your life? I'm going to test video games. What does it mean?
You know, it was a summer job that just was amazing. I went in there and I had to just basically try to break the game.
Wow.
You know, so you just play it over and over. Now, that position, quality assurance technician, I mean, video games, this is when it was a small, small company and we were just like, hey, go play the games. And,
right.
Have fun. But now it's a pretty regimented job and you've got like a structure to go through and use every item with every item and go in every room and do every possible permutation.
That's boring. Who wants to do
that? And it's on a grid and all that. But this was just go play games for the summer and
nice
try
job.
To break it. And
so how did you get into sound?
Well, I was testing and I came up with this way to log the bugs that made it so the programmers never had to talk to the testing. Because we were in the test pit. It was
the last
not a lot
place
of personal,
a
no personal hygiene.
Ooh, I could smell
yeah,
that
Yeah, you know, so it's like I made a way that over the network they could log their bugs into a database and then they would never, we could log our bugs and they would never have to see us. And so I, you know, that guy's great. He made it so we'd never have to talk to the testers. So at one point George Lucas was asking, he was coming up with this program called Soundroid, which was the audio sort of.
So he had Video Droid, which
was Video Droid and Edit Droid.
So
yeah.
And that was the early tap into the film, so they could see what he was shooting on film.
Yes. This was also, we would take the dailies for Edit Droid. They would take the dailies and either burn them onto the old laser discs, and so you'd have a non-linear way to cut. You'd have a huge bank of laser disc machines, all controlled by RS2 or 422. And then 232, I can't remember which one it was. It's a long time ago.
Was it parallel or serial?
It was...
232 serial.
I think it was 422.
That's
then.
Parallel.
Yeah, so it... so
now we're getting way...
It's way back, yeah. So then the Soundroid was going to be a complement to that, a nonlinear way to cut audio, and he wanted to develop it there on site, so he needed a tester. So he just we asked the video games division, we need your best tester. And they pushed me into
this
there.
This guy's good. We don't have to talk.
Yeah, so I got in there, and I had learned. My dad had, and my grandfather both were into tech. My grandfather was in broadcasting in the Bay Area.
Who was your grandfather?
His name was, he passed a few years ago. His name was Lee Noble. He worked for K-Ron, and he had a show in Marin. And so he had a lot of reel-to-reel tape recorders and tech in his house. And my dad would go to Japan a lot for his job and come back with all this tech that I would play with.
What did dad do?
He is a entrepreneur right now. He sells coffee. He worked for a drywall screw company. But he would go to Japan a lot, and then he would bring back
all this
little
stuff
micro
from the
cassette
Aki
recorders.
Harbor,
and
yeah.
So I got on our Mac. He bought us a Mac Plus almost 30 years ago, and I had a little Soundwave digitizer. So I would play with like sampling things from movies and stuff and cutting them together. And so when the sound job came up. I thought that was going to be this little sampler, but we were actually using these New England Digital Post Pros, they were called. They were mainly used as a sound design tool or a musician's tool called the Synclavier, and it was a direct-to-disc recording system with 16 tracks, and the machines cost about $300,000. They were the size of a refrigerator, but George wanted to make an interface for that was nonlinear, and it was for film, because he was trying to set up to do more Star Wars films.
Right.
And this was 1990, so...
So he'd done the first three.
The first three were done. Then he took time to raise his kids, produced a few films, and then he was just kind of getting the tech ready to know that he was going to do more.
You know, it's not that long ago, and yet it really is in technology an infinity ago.
It's crazy, but yeah, I mean, just thinking about, we were really cutting edge in what we did, and that was one thing George I loved working with him for, because he would take a 17-year-old kid's crazy ideas and financially back them and let us do new and exciting ways to make movies. And so we made this show called The Young Indiana Jones Chronicles for Paramount and ABC, and that so that was our sort of proving ground for Star Wars, to know that we could do digital technology and just change sort of the way that we were going to make films with sound and visuals and editing, and use that for when we started to work on the prequel.
I don't think people realize pre-1990, or even at that time, pre-1995 really, how different filmmaking was.
Yeah.
Because you had film. And
You had film. It's a physical thing. There's an artistry to that. It's funny now, because we shot the latest Star Wars on film. And even getting all the artisans back to do the color processing and all the telecinning and all that to work with that, even a few years out from digital, it's still hard to grab people to get those folks together, and you really got to hold on to them.
I watched a movie. I think it's on Netflix. 99 cents. No, it was 99 cents. So it must be. It was called. It was about the transition from film to digital.
Yeah.
Keanu Reeves was the host.
Yes. Yeah. He came. I think he interviewed George.
Yeah, he did. Yeah. And that really opened my eyes. Mm-hmm. As to how big a transition that was. For instance,
huge.
They call the guys, the colorists, they call it color timing.
Color timing. Yeah.
And the reason is because it was timing how long the film would stay in the bath.
Yeah, the photochemical process, yeah.
It was literally timing in the earliest days. And you really get a sense of how manually difficult that must have been to work with film.
Yeah, and even audio, same thing. I mean, we had
reel to reel, right?
Yeah, it was a reel to reel tape for what you'd go out.
Was it 8-track, 12-track?
We had, I mean, mostly if you're recording sound effects or dialogue or whatnot, you're using
a little Nagra or something?
It's a Nagra, yeah. And you'll do a stereo or mono. But then when you get your film, when you transfer it all into mag, which is basically 35mm sprocketed celluloid with magnetic stripes on it. It's just, and so you're now using the
it's like a reel to reel, but it's got film on it as well.
Film with the sprockets and everything. So you physically, the process was, you cut and splice, and if you want to put a fade on something, you actually go in and scrape the magnetic off. Yeah, I mean,
that's how you did a fade?
Yeah. I mean, you can do it other ways, but that's a crossfade. You'd actually just go ahead and cut a diagonal line
and
through the
overlap them?
And overlap. So it's, That was a whole artistry to that. So coming in the 90s to that, I came in to work with a bunch of artists that had been working in the same way films have been made since the inception of sound on film. So there was a lot of apprehension, like this whole new paradigm coming in. But the folks at Skywalker really rolled with it really well.
Yeah.
And we got onto that bandwagon really early. And we worked with Avid pretty early on.
That was the early nonlinear editing
tool. Yes. And so now most of our technology that we've put into it, we actually sold and licensed to Avid, and now that's part of the DigiDesign Avid Pro Tools. So, and it's an industry standard now. So that was very fortuitous for George to get involved in that early.
But he was part of that. He also drove it. I mean, credit to him for taking some leadership and saying, we want to do this.
Yeah, he loves that stuff. I mean, when we did, I think it was Attack of the Clones, which was the second prequel we did in 2001 to 1 and 2. That was the first major release of a film to ever be shot on completely on digital.
It's 15 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah. And he got a lot of kick, people blowback on that. Like theater owners were freaking out that they had to get digital projectors and cinematographers were freaking out. It's changing everything about their job. And
initially, it wasn't very good quality. Right.
Right. Right.
So there was a good reason to fight it.
Yes.
But George had some vision. I think it must have also been that he wanted to work that way, right?
He did. Yeah, he did. And he working non-linearly, he likes to cut. When he edits, he likes to cut in the third dimension in a way, like take a person from this scene and put them in the same scene and cut them together. I think he likes the puzzle game of putting it together in the process of that, and it's that to him was fun. He would really love history and also putting together a technical puzzle, I think, is and just all the pieces putting that together was very
satisfying. Was expensive. I mean,
yeah. Yeah.
That's it.
But those movies made some profit, I guess.
He had
Star
some money.
Wars films,
could do
you know, those, all the toys and licensing and marketing and all that. So
we're lucky when you know, I'm reading Elon Musk's biography, and we're lucky when you get guys like this who make a lot of money. Yeah. That instead of just going and sitting on the beach,
right.
they say, "What can I do next?
Yeah.
How can I use that money to forward my art?" In this case,
yeah. And he gave us that you speak of Skywalker Ranch, which, by the way, we have to get you out for a tour again.
Oh,
got to come out there.
It is beautiful. It's rolling hills.
Yeah.
It's trees. It's wooded. There's a place to stay if you're lucky enough.
There's an inn. Yeah, and it's. The amount of property that he purchased, he donated a large percent of it to Marin County Open Space so it can never be developed on. So
that's
there's
nice.
A giant buffer around us, and I think he can only develop on 10% of what he owns.
That has to be the only place in the world that you can work on films.
There's nothing.
In the woods.
I've worked all over the world on movies, and I've seen nothing like it.
It really
is special. To take what he had earned from those Star Wars films and put it back to a place where the employees can actually enjoy it was fantastic.
And coincidentally, it's on Lucas Valley Road.
Yeah, that's funny, which was called that before he bought it.
You have to think that he must have looked at it and said, we should buy here.
Yeah.
This is a sign.
Yeah.
We're talking to Matthew Wood. He is, I think you have the best title in the world. He is the executive, let me get it right here. Supervising, not executive.
That's right. No,
much
I'm not
better.
An executive.
That means
yes,
you work.
I actually, yes.
You do something.
I'm an artist.
Supervising sound editor at Skywalker Sound.
Yes.
He works at the ranch. That's all you have to say. And to people in our area, in the Petaluma area, working at the ranch is like, that's...
Oh, well, that's good
that's
to know.
That. Oh, yeah.
Yes. That means yeah, take that little back road out East Street.
Yeah.
Nice, yeah.
I love it. I'd love to come back out and see it. Our show today, we're going to take a break, come back with more. And yes, he's the voice of General Grievous. So I don't think you could do that,
I can
really.
I can do
can
it.
Can you?
I can do it.
It's not heavily processed.
It is. I process it too, but
you
I
can make
do that.
Your throat make
I can
that
do
sound.
That. Yeah, I'll turn out to
all
scare
right.
everybody when we come back.
We're live at the NAB show in Las Vegas, Nevada. Thanks to LiveView for letting it happen, and thanks especially to our sponsors who make this what is normally a very expensive process at least break even. Because I don't have Lucas money.
Right.
No.
Not.
I have General Grievous money. It's not the same.
I would, you know.
He probably made a little killing Jedi's. That's got to
sure.
be a good job.
Yes, yes.
He's got a little pay
residuals,
there.
Right.
Residuals.
Yeah.
Our show today. If you ever go, you know, people ask me, Leo, you're always going to stuff that you can't get tickets for. I have a secret. You can get tickets to almost anything. Score big.
Hmm.
So what's interesting? So you want to see the Warriors play now in the Bay Area? That's impossible. Of course, now it's the playoffs. You would love to go. Maybe there's a Heart concert that Lisa's demanding that we go to. How do you get tickets? Well, first thing you should understand, or Hamilton, how do you get tickets to Hamilton? It's sold out to next year. Okay, the first thing you have to understand is, now Hamilton is sold out, the Warriors are sold out, but there are lots of shows that don't sell out, and the promoters, the bands, don't want you to know that arena is going to go out 50% empty. They don't want that to happen. They can't make a big deal about it. They're not going to say, hey, we got cut-rate tickets, because that's embarrassing. So they go to Score Big. 40% of all live ticket events go unsold. 40%. So Score Big is a good business. They're kind of like a consolidator, right? They get the tickets, they sell them to you, and you save big, pay much less than box office. You're paying much less than face value on many of these seats, whether it's concerts, sporting events, Broadway productions, family-friendly events, you know, the skating shows and all that. They have an iPhone app. You got to get it. It's brand new. It makes it easier for you to purchase tickets anytime. And usually that's when I want to do it. I think of it and I go, oh, I got to get those tickets. Or I just heard about this. Now, here's one cool thing. They have a name your price feature, okay? So you name your ticket price at Score Big. There's a little slider that will tell you how likely you are to get a ticket at that price. So if you say a buck, it may be not, but you might be surprised at how little you can get some great seats for. And then they will tell you instantly, you'll be saving up to 60% on your tickets. Now, you can also pay a fixed price, often much less than major online ticket resellers. And the thing I love about Score Big is they're honest. So a lot of times you buy tickets online and you see, oh, that's a good price. By the time you checked out, it's another, you know, 20, 30% more with all the fees they add. Score Big doesn't do that. The price you see is the price you pay. There are never any additional fees. And the shipping is even free. So you know exactly what you're paying to see your favorite event. You can even, if you want, and I do this, you can favorite shows and events so you'll be notified on upcoming dates. and you'll be notified when events are available. So stop overpaying for tickets and go to shows that you didn't even think you could get a ticket for at scorebig.com. We're going to give you a special deal. If you go to scorebig.com, see in the upper right-hand corner the microphone there? Click that and enter the promo code Triangulation, $20 off your first purchase. And do get that iPhone app. It'll work with that, too. It is a great way to get tickets on the go. Scorebig.com. And don't forget our promo code, because we want them to know you heard it here. Triangulation. We're live from the NAB show in Las Vegas. Our guest, I'm thrilled to have him, Matthew Wood, supervising sound editor at Skywalker Sound. He's on the ranch. There's a cinema there. There's an inn, as you mentioned. There's is there a sound building?
Yes, there is.
It's called its own building.
It's called the Technical Building.
Yes,
and it's a large brick building that kind of looks like a vineyard.
You've been there 26 years. This is like home for you.
It is. I love it.
Nice easy commute.
It is. It's like a 25 minute commute from Petaluma on the back roads.
It's pretty. Yeah, you never a lot of time have to think. Traffic.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm spoiled. I keep waiting for the other shoe to drop, but it's been 26 years.
I think you got the job. What is a sound? I asked you this right at the very beginning, but I think I need to clarify.
Sure.
Because there's different jobs in sound.
Yes. Yes. There's you kind of break it up to, well, you have the production sound, which is recorded when you're shooting the film. We have
How much of that actually gets used?
A fair amount. You really want to
even
try to use...
Even on Star Wars, where there's a lot...
What you're using is you're pointing the microphones at the actors' mouths, because everything else you can recreate.
That has to match, though. It's very hard to do that.
Yes, so it's we have some shotgun mics and some lavaliers. Basically, it's a production team.
Wait a minute. Han Solo has a lav hidden away?
He does.
Is it like behind his lapel or something?
I think it is.
Yeah, like there?
Or in that little thing that holds the little pens or whatever that is.
What is that?
I'm not...
Is that bullets?
Sure.
I
don't know. What are those? You know?
Cylinders. Yeah. He's got, I don't know, they're EpiPens.
Maybe they're microphones.
I think they're EpiPens because I think, frankly, he has allergies.
Oh,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, from the Wookiee.
Every once in a while, he gets a Wookiee bite, and the Wookiee has to,
That's good. That's good. I'll go with that one.
So it could be where a microphone is. Yeah. We don't know, but that could
be. So, the production team, and then they record to usually a nonlinear device.
They're using, like, the sound devices stuff?
Yeah, the sound devices. Diva makes one. There's a lot of companies that make
them. So it's digital now.
Yeah, and they record to a BWF wave files that have the metadata with all the time of day, time code.
Okay, so that's not a common file format. BWF.
BWF. It's basically a WAV file with a ton of metadata in it.
Because you need to know.
Yeah, like
everything. Does it have the
time of day code?
The time code is on there.
Yeah, the time code, so you can sync with all the other devices that are on the set. And if the production mixer has time, he'll sometimes even type what each track is with, like, whose character is.
Editors love that because they can find it.
Exactly. So those are called the ISOs, the isolated mics. And so they do a mix down of that live while they're shooting that's to a little stereo track, which goes to the Avid so the editor can just cut something without having to listen. Because now these days, these recorders can have, 8, 10, 12, 24 tracks on them,
right,
depending on how many lavs and mics that the...
And they'll still use that for the final mix.
Yes.
But for the edit point, you just want a stereo.
For picture editing, usually you'll just... They typically use the mix down. But then when we get to the sound department, when it comes to my department, then we break down all the isolated mics and we can get in there and, separate out people better. Basically, the main thing you want to try to avoid is doing a lot of ADR, automated dialogue replacement, also called looping, where you bring the actors back into the studio and we do that re-recording process. That's one of the jobs that I specialize in, is the ADR.
That's got to be tough, because they have to match that perfectly.
It's most actors don't like doing it, but and also because you're trying to recapture what you had on
the
set.
Right, you're acting, but you have to do it just right, in the same speed.
You just do it over and over. It's called looping, because you'll play it over and over and kind of get the speed and rhythm right. And
they're watching themselves.
Yeah, they're watching it on a screen. They've got it in their headphones. And then, for a character, like if I use the example of the last film, the Star Wars film I did, the character Kylo Ren, he wears a mask. And so
that's a lot easier to loop.
Most of the characters that I've ever played, I do voice acting as well in animation and Star Wars, have no mouth. So it's
easier to
just put everything you want, anything you want in there. But for Kylo Ren, it was interesting because I wanted that character. I wanted his mask, because he wasn't a character like Darth Vader where the mask was keeping him alive.
Right.
It's more of an intimidation kind of thing. And I wanted the actor Adam Driver,
who's a wonderful actor,
amazing guy, yeah. Super nice guy as well. Like, yeah. I was talking to him.
Former Marine.
Yes, he's very method about his work too. So I was like, I want to take this to the next level for him. So I came up with a process of what I wanted Kylo Ren's mask to sound like, what it would sound like to the open air. And I came up with that and using a series of plugins and Pro Tools.
Oh, so he didn't actually have to wear something over it.
Well, he did. On the set, he wore the mask. And so most of what we were recorded.
Not looping.
No, no, no. Well, no. So what I did is.
Were you able to get recordings on the set?
Yeah, the recordings on the set were mainly used for a guide. And then also they sometimes get changed. I mean, J.J. Abrams will go through and.
You can rewrite Kylo Ren.
Absolutely rewrite Kylo Ren. So I made it so Adam could hear in his headphones what the mask was sounding like. And so, just like we were talking about earlier on the mics, he could get really microphonic up on the thing and do these really creepy, intimate kind of voices into the thing. And then it had that factor of scaring, like, the people that were in the room with him. So he could only do that if he had the process in his headphones. So it really made him able to play with the character. And I wasn't just taking his sound and just post-processing it without that additional performance.
Don't you wish all actors had to wear masks?
Do they, though? Really? All actors kind of do wear masks. We're all kind of wearing a mask.
How do you feel about actors?
You know, I am an actor myself as well.
That's so that's good.
That's why I do the ADR.
Yeah, because you can relate to them.
The communication between myself and another actor, I can say things in ways using terms that I think are easier to digest.
Some directors don't like actors. Hitchcock
didn't like
actors.
That is correct. There's been times where that I've seen that in action. Not on the Star
Never
Wars
with
films.
Anybody, yes.
No, never with know. Anybody that yeah. I'm getting a paycheck from. No, but no.
No, but I can see why, because they're hard. It's,
yeah, that's actors, they're artists. They're true artists, and you know, you got to take care of them. You got to be able to, you know, be sensitive with them, and a lot's riding on their shoulders, as is the director as well, but it's just a different kind of pressure. And I actually really enjoy working with actors. I think it's really fun. I enjoy the ADR process, especially if we can, something like that with the Kylo Ren, where I know what we did in ADR actually helped the movie. And it wasn't just a technical process of trying to replace a line that was too noisy or something.
Yeah.
And granted, these days, we live with a lot of noise on the track. I like the real world quality of something. If it had a little noise on it, big deal. People are, if you can hear what the lines are, you don't
blame
have to get
Altman
in there.
For this, right? Yeah. He really screwed us all up because
Robert
Altman loved to have everything talking all at once and all this overlapping,
a lot of overlapping
sound.
Dialogue. So that, and the noise reduction technologies now too are really amazing as far as taking something that has a background. Or a generator noise, or a fan, or something.
You just drop it out.
And just, you can get in there and really get surgical on it and drop out a lot of stuff. So that's also been another great development in sound technology. And the post side is the noise reduction technology is really at an all-time high.
So you have the mic ISOs. You have the final edit at this point.
Yeah, so the breakdown of the sound is the production team records the audio. It goes into the Avid. The whole thing goes into the Avid. Then we take the ISOs and the BWF files, and we ingest them into Pro Tools on our end. Once we get all the EDLs and the AAF.
The EDL is the edit list.
Yeah,
so that's
the edit list.
Instead of just giving you an edited film, they give you just the edit list and the bucket of scraps that you're going to pull.
And it targets, and we relink our BWF files in with the Avid's AAF file, which is the audio exchange. I can't remember what AAF stands for.
But that's audio.
That's an audio.
Audio interchange.
It used to be OMF. Now it's AAF. But it's basically all the edits in a form that can be digested into Pro Tools. We have all of that at our disposal, as well as the flattened QuickTime that comes from their Avid. And we
really, that's what you're using as a QuickTime?
Usually with an Avid codec. And then we take that into Pro Tools and we just start. That's
when
the
sitting
editorial team.
Now, Pro Tools is nice because you can use a mixer with Pro Tools, right?
The
mixer becomes a control surface.
Exactly. That's a new paradigm shift as well. And in post has been editors who now mix as well.
Right.
So it's and sound
designers. Interesting.
So
normally you wouldn't be sitting at the board.
Yeah.
You'd have an engineer sitting there.
We still do that. I mean, we still separate it out where it's. We have the editorial. The sound design department is basically the people going out, and anything that is too new and specific to be for that particular film, the sound designer will create. So that's
right. I need a Wookiee getting rolled over by a droid.
That would be like Ben Burtt, who was our
he's one of the world famous guys
that works at Skywalker. He was our famous sound designer.
Right.
And we had Ben Burtt and Gary Rydstrom, both amazing in their own right.
So you've got to do all those sound effects.
Yeah, they build those, and then we have an editorial team that comes together, and they synchronize everything to picture. So it's just cutting every single sound.
Does JJ come in for that final sync or no?
Yeah, he comes in for the final mix. That's where we have all of our material, all the sound design, all the ADR, all the production sound, all the Foley, which is another whole team where it's like an old radio play where they go and perform everything. Everything.
They still use coconuts for hooves?
You know, maybe on the Monty Python movie, but not. We haven't done that. That'd be great. Big sheet of metal for thunder. Yeah, no.
I always wanted to do a live radio play and have somebody doing
ADR.
Yeah,
all the
ADR
old world stuff. I love it.
And Foley, I mean, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So the Foley department.
Will they use real shoes though if they're making?
Oh yeah, yeah. We have the
They'll
Foley
have gravel on the.
Amazing. The Foley room is incredible. It's got 15 different types of surface on the ground. We've got every prop you could possibly imagine. There's a tank they can get into and do water Foley. It's basically anything that's too specific to be found in a sound effects library has to be recorded because the mics have always just been pointed at the actor's mouth, so everything else is gone. And if you want to make especially for the international release of the film, when you remove the dialogue, if that's tied to other things like picking up a glass while I'm talking, that glass pickup will be gone and they'll have to be reformed with Foley. So all that is done. It's then all the editorials matched perfectly to picture.
So essentially every sound effect is recreated.
Pretty much.
Even if it was recorded during the movie, you have to recreate it.
Yes, I'd say 99%.
So every door close, every footstep, every glass getting picked up is recreated.
Yep. Yeah,
Holy cow.
It's months and months of work to do that, and sometimes a year of work. The other thing that happens is a lot of these, especially in the science fiction sort of high-tech movies we do, the floors will be wood. In real life, you know, when they're on the set, it's a wooden floor. So when they're walking on it, you'll hear creaking and stuff. But they're supposed to be on this high-tech space floor. Space floor. You have to go and re-record all that to take the creaks out. And so
they're on a set that's creaking.
Sometimes, if they haven't locked it down, that's sort of the bane of the existence of a production recordist. They'll be like, "Oh, the floor's creaky." You know, they know they're going to try to have to get around it. But all of that is taken to the final mix, and that's where we have two or three re-recording mixers that take all of our editorial tracks in.
Still
and they
digital
balance
at
it.
This point.
It's all digital. Yeah, everything up analog. the whole process all the way through, up and even to the print master, to the various Atmos and formats is in Dolby.
Oh, I want to talk to you about those.
Yeah.
That's a whole new wrinkle. That's to consider,
yeah, it's
right?
amazing. So that final mix process is done usually in a movie theater sized room. We'll have the director in there. The supervisor, probably the picture editors, and then we have the mixers that are all up there. There'll be a music mixer, a dialogue mixer, and an effects mixer. And that process lasts anywhere from 5 to 7 weeks.
Amazing.
And that's where you're balancing the whole thing. That's
amazing.
That's the big moment where you're deciding what's going to be on the forefront to tell the story. That's where you do all the surround panning. That's where you do all the relative volume adjustments. And then you print master to the various formats, and you're finished.
We go in as fans. We go, we sit down, we pay our ticket price, and it's over in 2 hours.
Yeah.
There's so much detail in there, but all we get is just this wash of experience, right? That's all you can get as a fan. Now, of course, you've done your job right. You're going to create this emotional experience.
That's our whole goal in sound is to forward the story, give you an emotional experience. And the fact that you can do it almost subliminally with sound.
You should really never notice.
You're not seeing it. Somebody broke into one of the vehicles.
Who would think there'd be a car alarm on the show floor? That is something you don't expect.
Can't noise-reduce that.
Yeah. Can you take that out?
Yeah.
Okay.
See what, I don't know. This thing, I don't know.
But it's really true that if we notice your work, you're not doing your job.
Yeah, we want it to be, it just
Or do you secretly want them to say,
I mean,
that
there,
was
are
th-
there are
great
You've heard about the Wilhelm scream.
Yes,
that's
very
a little,
famous.
A
Tell
little,
us about the
that's
Wilhelm
a little
scream.
Calling card that Ben Bird and his buddies used to put in every movie.
How did people find out about it?
I think the word got out. It used to be a sound editor calling card to throw into a movie, but I think it hit. And with the, it, you know, everything can be YouTubed at this point.
Well, that's it. You can go on YouTube and find search for
super
Wilhelm
cut together of 100 films that do the.
So it came from somewhere, some sound effects library somewhere.
It was a sound effects library that Ben Burtt had come across that had. There it is. Excellent. I think that's Charge at Feather River.
And the scream is that,
Yeah, it's in so many movies.
We're watching.
There it is. There, yeah.
For those of you listening.
So that was a sound effects calling card that they, you know, there was just kind of an in-joke among sound people, but obviously now it's out to everybody, so, oh my gosh.
But, you know, I'll be honest, I'm watching Star Wars, I'm not listening for the Wilhelm scream.
I don't even,
it might happen, I wouldn't even notice.
I think it's the fact that those Star Wars films are watched hundreds of times by fans over and over that we try to pack it in there with as much little
Those films in particular, we know, and that's
the only film I've ever worked on where the hundreds of times I watch a movie when I'm working on it, and it becomes a whole new experience when you've watched a movie hundreds of times and you analyze a 20-second piece for a day, you know, like it becomes a weird sort of psychological thing. And I think the only movie that ever gets watched as much as we work on it would be the Star Wars films. Those probably, there are fans that have probably watched the movie as more the times than we've worked on.
Yeah.
Them, I think, so.
And that's gratifying, right?
Star Wars inspired me as a kid so much. And to be able to work on them is like, I still can't believe it's happening.
I can't believe we're getting to talk to you. I'm so thrilled. Matthew Wood is here. He's supervising sound editor at Skywalker Sound. We're going to talk more about how sound design has changed thanks to surround and Atmos now. It's coming from above. And, well, there's lots to talk about. Maybe we'll do a little General Grievous later on.
Not about Grievous.
Our show. we're so glad you're here. I'm glad you're watching. I'm watching the chat room. Thank you for being here as well. Mm-hmm. Our show today brought to you by DigitalOcean. This is so cool. It is the fastest growing, and this is in a very crowded space where there's some very big players, the fastest growing cloud infrastructure provider out there because it's built for developers. Developers love it. It is laser focused on its mission to create simple and elegant solutions for developers and teams. Here's the thing. You need to create a server to run Ruby on Rails or to run Django or to run WordPress or to run Closure or to run React, and you want to have it in public, and you want to have it operating, you want to develop as you're having users use it. DigitalOcean makes this so easy. You can provision a server, and I don't want to really even call it a server, but it is. You can provision a server in under a minute, and I've done it. In fact, if I had my laptop here, I'd do it for you right now. They call them droplets. They're virtual private servers. They can be easily customized, easily deployed. And they'll do anything that you want. Websites, web apps, production applications, personal projects. That's how I use it. Because it's so affordable, I literally can afford to have a server that I spin up and spin down. I can run a Minecraft server on it and just, you know, turn it off when I don't need it. Virtual desktops, anything you can think of with full root access. Over 600,000 developers use it. Father Robert Ballester uses it. Randall Schwartz uses it. Aaron Newcomb. You like containers? You want to use Docker? You can use Docker. You can destroy them and deploy them with just a click of the mouse using a streamlined control panel. There's also an API, though, which now if you start thinking about it, there's some really interesting things you could do with an API that could actually deploy a droplet for you. Many different OSs to choose from, Ubuntu, CentOS, Debian, Fedora, CoreOS, FreeBSD, and a variety of versions within those subsets. Select from lots of pre-configured one-clicks. So they've got Drupal, they've got Docker, they've got Node.js. It was so much easier to set up a Node.js server on DigitalOcean than do it myself. That's how I do it. You get all the infrastructure you need, root access to servers, 100% SSDs, so they're very fast. That's one of the reasons they can provision them so quickly. And they scale, too. So you can start, as I often do, with the cheap one, $5 a month, nothing. But if demand starts to ramp up, you can ramp up easily. Advanced features like floating IPs for high availability. They've got private networking, automated deployment via API. I mentioned that. Great community, too, and lots of tutorials. Just, you know, do a search for, you know, I don't know, configuring Rails on DigitalOcean, and you'll find a page. Django, how do I do a mail server? You'll find a page. It's so easy to get started. And it less than a minute, $5 a month. Or you can pay by the minute, by the way, or hours, I guess. About a penny an hour. We're going to make it so that you can start today, deploy an SSD cloud server for free, have it running for a couple of months free, Just go to DigitalOcean.com, create an account. That doesn't do anything, just creates an account. But once you confirm your email and your account information, if you go into the billing section, use the promo code Triangulation, and you get a $10 credit. That's 2 months. Plenty to get started and explore what DigitalOcean can do. I set up an account, I don't know how long ago, and I've been using it. I use it all the time. It's just a great way to just try stuff. You know, I'm kind of a language junkie, and I just like to try things. And it's really great for that. DigitalOcean.com. Don't forget the promo code Triangulation. Use that in the billing section once you sign up to get your $10 credit. I love it. You'll love it. If you're a developer or you want to learn, by the way, great place to learn. DigitalOcean.com. We are talking sound. We're talking Star Wars. We're talking with Matthew Wood. He's the supervising sound editor at Skywalker Sound. How many Star Wars movies have you worked on?
Good question. I worked on the restorations of episodes 4, 5, and 6. Then I worked.
You're reluctant to say that, I know.
No.
You don't mind?
No. Okay. That particular project, actually, working, restoring the first movie that was made, you know, episode 4.
1977?
Yeah, that one.
You actually got to
That movie was not, you know, obviously when they made that film, they didn't know it was going to be the giant hit.
No.
So the archival quality of how that film was sort of mixed and put together and archived was not the best as far as if you compare it to the other movies. So A colleague of mine, the sound designer David Acord, and I, who are huge Star Wars fans, we went through and got to basically reconstitute the film from the original units.
Man.
And it took months, close to a year.
Film canisters?
We had so much film. We had to transfer all the mag to digital. We had to find all the original production rolls, all the original ADR, and then go through the film in like 30-second chunks and kind of compare to make sure we had the right take.
And all of that was on tape.
That was all on real tape. We take all that tape into digital, though, so we had it in Pro Tools to be able to manipulate.
So you had somebody digit all first.
Yeah, Skywalker Sound's transfer department went through and did all of that for us. And then so once we had that all lined up, we could go through piece by piece, find the right sound effects, find the right dialogue. And Ben Burt works at Skywalker Sound, so he was there every once in a while. I'd bring him in on a reel to hear things. Is this what you remember?
Oh, and that must have been fun.
Yeah, and George, too. So George came in at the very end and watched it all. And the original, the fun thing about the whole process was just, it's the only film, I think, that for me, I could have listened to and I would know that something wasn't right because I'd watched it so many times as a kid. If I picked the wrong sound effect or the wrong dialogue take or something was
like,
you
knew it by heart.
I could just feel it in my DNA, you know?
Man.
So that, and just also learning how they crafted those films. Like back then, a mix process was not automated. It was a live thing. It was like all
somebody's
the mixers are sitting there.
The
they've
faders.
Got grease pencil on the faders to know at what times they got to move. And they say, everyone ready? The music, dialogue, sound effects. Here we go. We're going to do this scene. And they would just do it. And if someone was off slightly, and 85% of it was okay, they just have to say, we're
live
going forward. We can't redo that because it was a craft. And
wow.
And so the thing that also people don't realize is that if I just took the masters that were made in 77 and just transferred them and put them on Blu-ray and you heard them, it would not be the same experience that you would sort of emotionally remember from your in the theater. Like in the theater, it was probably the whole room was rumbling. I felt the Star Destroyer go over my head and all those things.
Yeah.
And so if you play that on a 7.1 system, back then it was stereo surround, maybe LCRS if you were lucky. You know, or LRS and left, right, surround. But I had to make it 7.1, expand the dynamic range out to what the speakers are capable of now. So you feel the booms and you feel the surround. And so, but also keep it within that same structure that it doesn't change the balance between music, effects, and dialogue. So that's what I had Ben Burt and George Lucas there for.
You know, people sometimes, and I know you know this, sometimes complain about the restoration.
Yes,
but they're complaining about changes.
Yeah.
But what you really did is it's like an old painting that you brought back to life.
That's how we treated it from the sound position. It was like, I want people to feel like they felt when they saw it first, but I also want it to be, if you put this movie in against any of the ones we did, you know, the prequels, that it's going to feel in the same range of audio. The booms are going to be boomy. The surround's going to be aggressive, and it's going to have that feeling, and the balance is going to be what you remember. So it was that's a tough. I mean, when you're dealing with something like that, especially the fan response is also huge on anything that's different. So we got the film to a certain point, and then, you know, handed it over to George to make his adjustments. So I think those adjustments, you know, people have an emotional response to how they saw the movie whenever
it was.
Yeah,
you know, it's you know. I think he probably didn't even realize that it... When somebody sees this movie and they're 15 years old and then they memorize it,
Now
you can't change it because you're changing their childhood. This is... you probably feel that way.
No,
this
I know.
This is precious to you.
Yeah, absolutely. So I worked on those, 4, 5, and 6. We re-released them in the theaters in 97, and then Blu-ray, 2004 DVD, and then 2011 for the Blu-ray.
Must have been fun to work on. I mean,
oh, my God.
Wow.
That's like just holding the production roll in my hand.
Yeah.
The production rolls had not been touched since 77 because they were transferred to the select takes were transferred to magnetic film, and the originals were just sealed in a box. And we thought they were gone. In 2004, when I did the DVD restoration, we never found them, but we found them literally like a crate in the Raiders of the Lost Ark kind of situation. So I found the original production.
Now, what condition were they in?
Perfect.
I mean, the Mylar,
perfect.
They weren't flaking off?
You opened the thing up, and it was like this big vinegar-type smell coming out of the box. I was like, uh-oh. Put them up. There were certain vintages of quarter-inch film that the glue backing would stick, and you'd had to put them in a heater to actually heat the glue to a point where you could play them again. But these were perfect.
They didn't even
and everything, just the handwriting of the people that made them, and just knowing that production roll was what was shot on film. That was in Tunisia, or that was in the scene. It was just, as a fan, that's a huge part of that process. So we did those 4, 5, and 6. Then we did the prequels. I supervised episodes 1, 2, and 3. Then we did the Clone Wars movie. That was in 2008. And then we did about 120.
So you worked
episodes
on every
of that.
One of them.
Yeah, ever since I started there, I'm like the Star Wars sort of supervisor. So I did. I happened just coincidentally to work with J.J. Abrams on two films with him. On the Star Trek film, I supervised him.
Oh, love that too.
And Super 8. So when he got the Star Wars movie,
sound in Super 8 is fantastic.
Oh yeah, that was a fun.
That is a big sound movie.
A train wreck and everything.
Yeah.
There. So I did The Force Awakens, and now I'm working currently on Episode 8 and Rogue One.
Do you only work for other movies?
It used to be that we had a couple of years between Star Wars movies, and
so
I would I would work for Pixar. I did WALL-E. I've worked for Paul Thomas Anderson. I did
One of my
There
favorite
Will Be Blood
directors.
And The Master and Inherent Vice.
The Master was amazing.
That was on 70mm film, which was a whole other process watching how to get that 70mm technology back up again. But so now we want to do one every year. We have a Star Wars release every year, and so it's really gonna Lucasfilm's gonna go into all thrusters firing mode here.
So when you see guys like J.J. or Anderson who want to shoot on film, Tarantino still shoots on 70mm. How do people think of that?
I think it's romantic.
Romantic.
I think it's emotional.
I think it is romantic.
I think it's... and if it... You know, I saw the Roadshow version of the last Tarantino film, Hateful Eight.
Hateful Eight,
I thought it looked wonderful. I thought all those...
Those beautiful scenes.
Are they in Wyoming? Is that the Tetons?
Oh,
yeah, it was
man.
Incredible. And hearing just the love of the craft that Paul put into the master to get the 70mm going again and seeing all those artists come together.
So those cameras are not... They're vintage cameras at
vintage,
this point?
Yeah, vintage lenses, vintage cameras. And it's also... They're incredibly noisy, so that's one thing.
Right.
Blimping those has always been a challenge. Like all the IMAX stuff, which is like 70mm on its side, you know.
You hear the sprocket noise.
You can hear that, yeah.
Chattering.
So sometimes that gets, for the sound part of it, you're like,
okay.
Do
they put a box around it?
They box it, they blimp it as best they can, yeah. So, but sometimes it gets through, and that's hard to pull out of the noise.
So it might get into the dialogue.
So sometimes you have to loop those scenes. But, you know, I love... When a director has passion for something, and sometimes it's the format, I love it. I think it's great.
Right.
Yeah, because our post-production chain it doesn't really change that much because it's
digital by the time you get it.
When
no
I get it,
what.
It's digitized. Yeah. And so then it's a surprise for us when we get to watch it when it's finally all done and we can see it in the screen. Like, whoa, look at that 70mm beauty.
What? How do they put the audio on? They put it on the celluloid, right? On the, print?
It's all double system. So it's okay. Yeah, a lot of...
Okay.
Actually, that's not so true. I don't know how they do it with 70, but I know between the sprocket holes they can put the SRD information.
So it's not back to the Cinerama days of having the sound on
the six-track mag.
Yeah.
No, they don't do that. Yeah, but it's double system with digital. They can put a time code on the outside of the viewing area on the celluloid that it goes to double system playback.
So it's synced up.
Yep.
Yeah. Oh, this is so much fun. As somebody in the chat room Actually, Burke is saying audio nerds are rejoicing, right?
Oh, great. Good. Audio nerds.
Yay, audio nerds. We love you. So let's talk about your voiceover work. How'd you start doing that?
You know, that was I'd always done acting in high school, and
you're living your dream, my friend.
So when I got the job at Lucasfilm, it was really, you know, a lot of time requirements there. So I had to kind of give up on some things, but I did as much, you know, theater I could at night, and then I ended up, I realized that the gear that I'm using to do my sound work, I could also do acting with. So I was able to audition for a few things, or every once in a while it'd be someone who, hey, we need a voice for this scene, or hey, we, you know, can
that's kind of how I imagined it, is like,
yeah, so some of those things would drop in.
Yeah,
but so on Grievous, I'd done a fair amount. Like I had played the character Bib Fortuna in the Phantom Menace. He stands next to Jabba the Hutt in the pod race scene. And so George had me, because I had the same physical features as what the makeup required. So he's like, go down to ILM.
So you're actually... Can we pull up Bib Fortuna?
It would be the Phantom Menace version of Bib Fortuna. But I did that. And then when we got to doing Revenge of the Sith...
Is that funny, though, to go... Now you're on the set. You've been doing all this time.
It's amazing.
Is it so different?
It was all green screen, you know, so Jabba the Hutt was a light stand. And, you know, and I didn't really have much direction, so I went out kind of thinking, oh, it's Bib Fortuna. He was in Return of the Jedi, and he had this, like, kind of crazy look. And so they dressed me all up in it, and I got out on stage, and I did the same thing. And I remember... No, we're going to go for more of a serious bit this time. So just really
just
serious.
Pull it down a little bit. Yeah.
So, yeah. I go out and it's only like less than a minute, but it's.
Oh, no, but what fun, right?
Yeah. Jabba spits a frog at me or something like that. But
actors on the stage. It was all.
There was a couple of. There was someone in like a Slave Leia outfit. There might have been. There was a couple other aliens in the scene, but
it's got to be hard to work on a green screen for actors.
As a actor like that does plays and stuff, I actually enjoy it. I mean, of course, a gigantic set would be easier to fill in your mind, but right. I think, you know, actors have to do it all the time.
That's what you do.
In a play,
that's what you
know?
Do. Your concentration, your imagination are all at play.
But I will say, seeing the sets on The Force Awakens. Were pretty incredible.
Because like, they were a lot of practicals.
Everything the Millennium Falcon is a fully functional practical set. It's got the hallways, it's got the ramp, it's got the little chess area and Chewie's little chill out area, and then down and it goes around the corner down to the cockpit.
What?
You can sit in it, and I got to sit in the cockpit, and I remember I've worked there forever, but they're like, you know, you can't take any pictures, and I'm like, oh my god, this is like, if there's any time I've ever wanted to do that, it'd be right now.
Luckily, promise I won't show anybody.
The stills photographer was there that day, and I was like, could you please get me a couple of shots of me? Just kind of...
Oh,
so
man.
Somewhere in the archives, I got to get those.
Well, even George didn't do that. I mean, you got to honor JJ for wanting to build
There was a Millennium Falcon shot. I obviously didn't see it because I was a kid, but there were those.
They did build
things,
some stuff.
But yeah, the sets at Pinewood were pretty extensive on Force Awakens, and that was just fun to see that and walk around in those.
Han Solo sit down there. That's got to be a thrill.
Yeah, working with Harrison Ford is obviously a legend.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was a total dream. So the acting thing for the voice, we were getting to the point of close to the end of Revenge of the Sith, and we still didn't have a voice lockdown for that character, General Grievous, who was the sort of bad guy. And the Industrial Light and Magic had done most of the animation at that point, and once again, the character has a bone face. He has a face that doesn't have any moving parts, so the voice could come in
there
pretty late.
There he is.
Oh, yeah, there he is.
Yeah.
Alter ego.
Wow.
But it's a completely digital character, so we came up with what we wanted him to sound like, the process of how we wanted him to have, because it's a voice synthesized. I mean, the logic is that it's being synthesized inside of his being there.
Right.
So we didn't have the actor content for that. And so we had auditioned 30, 40, 50 people, all different types of voices, and George just really didn't have what he wanted. But he kind of would handpick, I like a little of that, a little of that, a little of that.
So you know you're going to heavily process
later, I mean,
right?
The process was basically some ring modulation, and I pitched it down a little bit in the formant, and that was about it. But it was completely generated by an actor's performance. You cannot synthesize that.
Interesting.
So... The last time, did the voice casting.
Probably highly illegal, whatever this we're playing right now.
Last time we did a voice casting for it, my buddy Chris Scarabosio, mixer, was like, hey, you know, put your own voice in there. Just do it. And I was like, and so I go up to the mic and I did a few versions of what I thought George wanted. George wasn't in the room.
Right.
Took all those files, processed them all the same exact way with the ring modulation and the formant down pitching, and put a fake name on mine, just like, because I just put initials for all the actors, and I just put a fake name on mine, sent it up to George. Week goes by, I don't hear anything, and then I get this call from the producer saying, George picked a voice, he finally got one, we got to get that actor out here, we need AS, whoever that is. And so I look on the list, oh man, there's no AS on here, I screwed up, I don't know, I didn't do my logging right, what did I do? And then I just, oh, it's me!
Oh, you got the part!
So yeah, it was pretty
independently thrilling. Cast too, he didn't know.
Yeah, that's, and good. So then I told the producer, hey Rick, that's me. And he's like, what? What do you want me to do? And I said, just tell him. Just tell him. So I told George, and George was thrilled.
Why wouldn't he be?
He called me the next day, and he was like, let's go and record the whole thing. And also, it was great for him because he could change the dialogue a million times, and I was right there.
The guy works for me.
So that character and Grievous and a bunch of other voices that I did for the Clone Wars series.
You were in the Clone Wars.
Yeah, I did a bunch of characters on that, and that was like, we did 100-plus episodes.
Is that
episodes.
Fun? You like
that?
Oh,
I love it. It's great. We do it like a radio. It's like a radio.
Oh, podcast. You're actually doing it with other actors.
Yeah, the whole cast.
Oh, nice.
And we go through the whole
thing.
That's
not always done that way. A lot of times.
No, a lot of times you can't really get the luxury of doing that. I'd actually fly down to LA and record at LA Studios down there with the cold cast. And
that would be really fun.
Oh my gosh, I love it. And it's all Star Wars, and we get a lot of guest stars coming in that really, you get to see the love of Star Wars as they perform, and their kids are loving it. And
yeah.
So that was, and so I did a few voices on Force Awakens as well.
But, Alan Smithy, was that?
That was Alan Smithy. Yes. Good guess.
That's the traditional. Nom de plume of actors
That's
who
right.
want to perform in
That's what
place.
I did.
Yeah. A.S.
A.S.
You gave me a clue. We're going to take a break and maybe we'll get a little general. I hate to,
I can do it.
I hate to do
we'll
that.
We'll do it. We'll come back to the break.
You want a little something to, you know.
No, I'm good. I'm ready.
Ravel up
I'm
the
ready.
Throat. Well, okay.
We come back, I'll do it.
There he is. There's some inspiration for you.
I'm ready.
Matthew Wood is our guest. He's supervising sound editor at Skywalker Sound. We're doing the show, as you probably could tell, from a pretty big place. It's the NAB show in Las Vegas, the big National Association of Broadcasters show. We're here in the Central Hall and having a great time. We're going to do an iOS today in a little bit. TNT's coming up, and lots of coverage of cool toys from the NAB show in just a little bit, but more with Matthew. I'm having a blast here talking to him. Mm-hmm. Our show today brought, you see, if you love movies, people love movies. Those are good people. Good people. I love documentaries. Our show today brought to you by CuriosityStream. John Hendricks, the guy who founded Discovery, put together the world's first ad-free nonfiction streaming service. They're building it up all the time. 1,400 titles, 600 hours of content. It's available pretty much worldwide, 196 countries. That's nice. Web, Roku, Android, iOS, Chromecast, yes. Amazon Fire, Amazon Kindle. Yeah, they have an Apple TV app. Curiosity Stream has lots of great stuff, not just documentaries, but interviews, lectures. They've got Stephen Hawking's Universe, Next World featuring Michio Kaku. I know a lot of you are fascinated by science and physics. Michio's been on the show, and that's a really great show. The Human Face of Big Data, that's Rick Smolin's show. We've had him on, too. That's on Curiosity Stream. You're interested in the singularity? I know we talk a lot about this idea. The road to the singularity, Jason Silva and other experts. Monthly and annual plans available. It starts at $2.99 a month, so it's a lot of fun. About the cost of maybe less than the cost of one Starbucks or the cost of one title on those other platforms. But we got a really good deal for you. Go to curiositystream.com/twit. Use the offer code TWIT during sign up. You'll get unlimited access to the world's top documentaries and nonfiction series free for 2 months. 60 days. 60 days free. So really no reason not to do this right now. CuriosityStream.com/twit. By the way, they have a huge 4K library. It's about 50 hours of 4K content. They just launched that. It's one of the largest 4K libraries on the internet. So if you just got a new TV and you're looking for something to show off the TV, this is the place. CuriosityStream.com/twit. And don't forget that offer code TWIT for 2 months free. Oh, look, they got some Earth Day stuff. The Great Barrier Reef. The Science of Walking with Beasts. I have no idea what that is, but I want to watch it. Our guest is the... Now I'm going to introduce you as the voice of General Grievous. The Alan Smithy is here. No, yes. Matthew Wood, the supervising sound editor at Skywalker Sound. We are so thrilled to have you
I'm thrilled to be here.
And man, for somebody so young to have worked on every single Star Wars film, all of the animated series, to have voiced characters in the Clone Wars.
Yeah, we're doing, we have another series we're doing, Rebels. That I'm.
Are you on Rebels?
I do a couple of voices on that, just stormtroopers and rebel pilots and whatnot. But we're also, I'm doing the sound on that as well. So
fun.
We just wrapped our second season.
Is animated easier? It must be easier.
It's easier in some respects. Production sound obviously doesn't exist, so
right.
You can cut it all from
whatever
ADR.
You want. Yeah.
But you know, it's still, you pack in a lot of information into those 22-minute episodes. It's almost, and with Star Wars, the expectation is that the quality level is going to be pretty high. So we want those Blu-rays when someone plays it or wherever, you know, whatever streaming service they play from, to be able to have it be on parity with what's right. come before. So you have to, we right. have to keep that up. But it's a great. Rebels is a great proving ground for us, because I can bring in people to mix and cut and edit. That's sort of their training ground, and I've got a great mixer on there. This one, Bonnie Wilde, is doing a fantastic job on Rebels for us.
You need to do that. You got to bring in the next
absolutely.
Generation. They have
everyone
to...
loves working on that's for me.
Well, that's
everyone
easy
loves
to hire
Star
somebody.
Wars, so I can grab people that just have such passion.
Yeah.
Utilize it. No, it's great to have.
They work for practically nothing.
Yeah.
I would. Anybody would, right? Yeah. I mean, what an opportunity to get to do that. Do you do that in L.A. or do you do it up here?
We do it all at Skywalker Ranch.
Nice.
Yeah, Skywalker Sound is 100% based in Nicasio, California, at Skywalker Ranch. And thankfully, and
it's
we
a beautiful place.
We just, yeah, we love
beautiful
it.
Beautiful area. So surround now and now Atmos.
Yes,
you're mixing
Atmos.
This. How many channels now do you have to?
Well, Atmos, it's kind of changes the whole way.
This is Dolby's new sound that comes above
it's
from
basically,
above.
It's basically, it's point-based, object-based sound.
Oh, so it really is anywhere.
It's anywhere. If your theater has 100 speakers, we'll scale to those 100 speakers. If it has
how
50,
do you do
we'll
that?
Scale to that. So it's metadata, basically. All the panning, XYZ metadata is attached to certain sounds.
But you have to mix for each one of those.
Yeah. Well, no, we mix. Right? We mix for the
most elaborate.
Yeah, we just have a standardized sort of Atmos setup that we have that we mix for. But this will, because it's object based, it can scale. Like if you had, you know, 10 speakers in your corner, and the sound's going to travel across those 10, it's going to know how to do it instead of just like, you know, blanket those like an LCRS like a discrete sound. It's more object and point based.
It's like a vector drawing for sounds.
Yeah,
it scales to any size.
And we have panners that we do XYZ. For example,
do you use regular headphones to mix that, or how?
No, you do it in a movie theater.
You have to do it in a theater.
Yeah,
because you need the space.
You need the space. You need to push air just like you'd be hearing in a theater. So there's speakers above us now. There's a proscenium set of speakers above the left, center, and right. There's, you know, more speakers in the back. But it's just mainly you're scaling your... Now your data of what you've made, your mix can be scaled to whatever theater, however they want to, they play it back. And it's very interesting.
There is a theater at Skywalker. Is that the theater you use?
Yeah, we have the theater called the Stag Theater. It's a really nice playback theater. We have a lot of screenings in there. That's
right.
Got Atmos.
Right.
We've got a couple of our mix rooms have Atmos. But yeah, it's kind of the new way to do this. It's very exciting.
So you want to mix that way?
Absolutely,
to do that.
And we like, because having that those channels above you is interesting too, to build an environment and an atmosphere. You had to have that kind of above you is great. Like even a subtle thing, like the music in Force Awakens, when it was recorded, they put a tree of microphones way high up in the
theater. You'd have to,
in there. And so we can actually point that now. We can take those microphones and put them above you in the theater now. So that natural reverb that's happening up there is actually what you're hearing above us. So
you do. You have to change how you record.
Yeah.
Because you need that data. You're not simulating that data.
Right.
That's real.
Right. And the panning now can be done all around you and with more... accuracy to how we've mixed is being more accurately played back in the theaters now. It's metadata.
That's exciting.
To sound. It's very exciting.
What do you do to protect your hearing? This is kind of your
what?
Huh?
No.
No. You got to be careful because I bet the temptation is to turn that up.
Yeah. Really... Like, for example, that movie Super 8 you were talking about, there's a train crash sequence in there.
It's a loud sequence.
And that scene, we probably worked on that for like 2 or 3 days straight
sounds
in the mix.
So good.
So at a certain point, you are putting in your earplugs because you just can't listen to 85 decibels of that like that. But there are there's a company that comes along and gives us, and they take a mold of the inside of our ear, and then you can pop out and in the different decibel reduction size earplugs depending on what you're listening to. So you want to definitely be careful with that.
Because I'd be so tempted just to crank it, you know.
Yeah, you want to save the crank it moments for very special moments. Yeah.
Those great Rebel speakers, man, they sound fantastic.
Yeah.
That's what you use in the, I know it's in the booth in the symphonic stage, it was Rebel speakers, I think.
Yeah, I think, we have a scoring stage, and that's a separate division of Skywalker. I'm not quite certain.
What do you guys use?
We have Meyer speakers.
I asked for the audio files we're listening.
Yeah, we
want to know all the details.
I'll use a lot of Meyer speakers in our cutting rooms and our design rooms. I'm trying to think about what's in our stag. It changes out so much. I don't actually know what's in the stag.
Changes because there's better stuff coming.
Yeah, just all the time. Better technology, better.
So that's probably the best theater in the world.
That theater, people have played movies. Directors have come to play their movies to screen there, and they say they hear things in that theater that they didn't even hear when they were working on it.
Nice.
So that's a nice compliment for that place. The engineers have really set that up very well.
Do you worry? I sometimes think that I go into a theater and it's too loud. There was a movie I saw recently. I won't name names.
Yeah.
But it was painfully loud.
Yeah, I could see that, and sometimes that everything will suffer because of that, because then the theater owner will turn the volume knob down, and then the whole mix is gone at that point.
Well, I checked, and this was intended to be played at this high level.
Yeah.
A lot of people complained about this.
Yeah, that's not great. I mean, we try to keep things respectful and impactful.
But you tell the theater what level they should be playing.
Yeah, it's Dolby. It's a standardized
setting. It's built into that.
We mix at an 85 decibel level for our peak. Level, and then we
see that's safe. That's a safe sound. Pressure.
And so we can go beyond it occasionally, but we don't. You try not to
sustain it anyway.
Yeah, the trailers have that same thing too, where you really they actually have a governing board that has a meter that takes an average of what you do on your trailer, and you can't go over a certain decibel amount on an average over the trailer, or you get kicked back.
You have
too
to.
Loud.
Because
all
people be tempted. They want to get your attention.
Every trailer is loud to the point now where they're all in that zone, in that really crushed sort of compressed zone. You can't, if you make a trailer that's not like that now, it just won't play up next to the other trailers well. So that's why the theater owners also turn the volume down for the trailers. So sometimes if they don't turn it back up for the movie, you're going to be playing down at a low level. It's, you know, a lot of that standardization we're hoping gets, you know, fixed with the fact that it's all the playback systems are digital, and hopefully there's some kind of uniform.
It's actually the bane of pop music is compression. Is they're over compressing this stuff.
Absolutely.
And you're losing music.
And it all sounds the same at a certain point. Yeah.
It's all crunch, crunch, crunch.
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to let you go because I'm sure you have something. What are you doing here?
We're giving a talk later on today at 3 o'clock about some of the ways we made Force Awakens.
Oh, so, man. I want to see that.
Industrial Light and Magic will be there talking about some of the visuals. I'll be talking about sound.
Fun. Do you go to the fan fests ever at Comic Con?
I do because of the General Grievous connection. I do that now. Even though I worked for the company for 26 years, I did some voice work, and that's what people want to see. So,
of course they do.
You know, some of the characters I played in the Clone Wars, these dorky little battle droids, the little Roger guys, they're called.
And people go, oh!
Yeah, and then Grievous. You know, and that's super fun for me because I go to these shows, I meet fans. I probably would be at the show if I wasn't working there. And,
yeah.
You know, and who knows what I would have been doing. But taking the passion of fans back to the ranch with me, I'm like, I just went to a show where 1,000 people were just cheering for our... You know, for our movie, and so that is my unique perspective that I get to take back, and not a lot of folks at Work and Sound get to have that relationship with the fans directly. So that's really fun for me.
Yeah, I think it's important, and that's good that you can bring that back. Because I'm sure working at the ranch is so beautiful, so pastoral. You probably lose track of the fact that you're making something that people are. Crazy.
Yeah, that's the one. That's when always it comes around when we make a film and you see all the licensing and marketing and all the everything out there. Star Wars, you're like, wow, like that. We're this little drop in the bucket out there, and then it just ripples out over the entire world. It's a very,
all right,
very unique.
Give us a little General Grievous.
So he's always mad. So he has this little like growly thing that he does. So he's like, he'll say.
Now remember, this is minus the ring.
Yeah, the ring modulation, but it's still he'll say like,
"You fool! I've been trained in your Jedi arts by Count Dooku."
Yeah. Okay, that's all I'm going to make you do.
Excellent.
That's awesome. You did great. Matthew Wood, thank you so much for being part of the
show.
Thanks
a lot, Leo.
This was really great.
Very nice
great
to meet you.
Great to
meet
you.
I'll see you in Petaluma.
Please come by.
Right.
You're a local. And I'll see you at the Butter and Eggs Day Parade next weekend.
Yes, that's right, next weekend.
Next weekend, okay. The big parade.
All right.
You, Matthew.
Bye-bye.
We do Triangulation. Oh, man, what fun. Every Monday, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern time. That is 1800 UTC. Love it if you watch live, because I do pay attention, even here on the road, to the chat room and your questions. We try to integrate them in, and, of course, the direction you want to take. But if you can't watch live, you can't be at irc.twit.tv to chat, don't worry, because we make on-demand audio and video of all of our shows available after the fact. Just download it from twit.tv/TRI. This is one show. You really have to listen to every episode. We have great, great people on this show. It kind of blows me away. So make sure you subscribe, use your favorite podcast application or one of the great Twit apps. We didn't write any of them, all written by our fans who are fabulous on every platform, Roku, Apple TV, Android, iOS, Windows Phone, Windows, everywhere. Get the Twit app, subscribe, don't miss an episode. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next week on Triangulation. Bye-bye.